So let's move on the APIs part. So let's start talking about the APIs from, of course, their specifications. They were defined in August 2015, more or less. The date is not really precise. And they were written in the API, I don't know how to pronounce exactly this website. So those are the specifications are available on internet using the link specified in the slide. So the main aim of the Future Gateway APIs is to deal with the task management. We used the word task instead, for instance, of job, that is the common way to think about distributing when we are dealing with the distributing infrastructure. For instance, we send a job on a grid. In the case of Future Gateway, our intention was to provide a mechanism to not only send jobs, but also instantiate virtual machines, instantiate with INDIGO, for instance, PaaS, or execute a job inside a virtual machine. So this is a kind of generic mechanism was identified as a task. So in the naming convention of the Future Gateway, what we were thinking at the time of grids became tasks. So a task, we have, of course, API calls to manage tasks in the form of a collection. Then a task is linked with an application that is the generic way to think, so the most way, the better way to explain so the task is that the task is an instance of an application, and an application needs information to execute on a physical infrastructure, and this kind of information is stored inside the infrastructure collection. Then we have, in the future, we will have also API calls to manage users, groups, and roles. So, as I told you, tasks are instances of applications, but application can define something that execute somewhere, but also could be something that is creating an infrastructure. So we have the way to specify this on the APIs. We have also the possibility to send or receive files from the distributed infrastructure. We can pass arguments in order to change the behavior of our submission. We can we have to define as well the technical parameters to interact correctly with the targeted distributed infrastructure. When we define an infrastructure, normally we use a set of pairs defining a key value and its value. And for instance, when we define JSAG adapter settings, we use such a way. We will see. I will show during this slide how. Inside the infrastructure settings, we have also other special settings that are piloting other third-party components, for instance, the e-token server parameters. I will also show you later some details about this. So again, we can also manage groups and roles and users. So this is the classic classic way to explain the REST call in a generic fashion. So we have the protocol name on the left, HTTP or HTTPS, accordingly to the configuration given in the front end. Then you have to provide the host name and port where the front end is listening to. Then you have to provide the version of the APIs, in this case version 1.0. Then which kind of action you want to ask, and optionally a set of parameter values. So this is the generic way you interact with the Future Gateway APIs. The supported methods implemented in the front end are involving the get, the post, the patch, and delete. Any input that you provide to the APIs will be in JSON format. And the output of any request will be JSON as well. And inside there is a, inside the JSON, you will see also the underscore link field containing also the action that are related to the REST API call you issued. The REST calls are also in charge to deal with the token management. And this is accomplished with the specifying it in the header section of the REST API. And you can also use as a filter the user field in order to specify a different username. So this is useful, for instance, for a user to operate on behalf of some other user. Some convention used by those slides. So all examples I'm going to provide you now are exploiting the curl command. It's a very powerful tool in order to explain APIs. I'm not using this tool, it's a JQ on those slides, but this is a very useful field to filter JSON outputs. So you may be write scripts that are using this tool to filter out, for instance, the application ID from an answer or the job status, the task status during execution. All those examples I'm going to show will not use the tokens. I will just explain the token management concentrating everything in just one slide. So in case the token management is switched off, because you can specify this behavior configuring the front end, in this case you configure also in the configuration file which is the default user that will be used by the Future Gateway. So the first, before to start with the API, I will introduce briefly some database table used by the API server. So on top you can see the application table. The application table contains generic information about the installed application for the Future Gateway. Each application has application file table specifying which files are using the application, the parameters piloting the behavior of the application, and the infrastructure that are specifying the technical details to interact to a specific distributed infrastructure. An application instance is a task. So as soon as a user submits a task, the task, a record will be created in this table. The task contains information about provided arguments, input files, output files, and this table, runtime data, is a way that a task can share information with the user. So, for instance, a task that is creating a virtual machine can exploit this runtime data to publish the IP address of that virtual machine to the user. This is just one simple example I can do. And finally, we have the queue table that is processed by the API server daemon component. This is explaining the fields related to the application and the application-related tables. I don't want to go in detail here, so you can watch these slides later on. This is the schema, the links between task and task tables. And finally, we have the queue table linking the task. Then we have information about the target identifier. For instance, if it is a grid job, you have a reference to that grid job from this ID. So the status of the future gateway, of the APIs, the relay status on the target, and then some information about the timestamp of the last change, when the task has been enqueued, etc. So let's start our API explanation, starting from tasks. So in order to show the list of all tasks, you can use this call. So for instance, you can use curl, HTTP, host, port, version, and then the word tasks. This will return a JSON containing a field tasks and inside a vector with the task description. So we have information about the submission date, which is the last update of the status timestamp, the list of input files, output files, which is the application related to the task, arguments eventually provided while submitting the task, the section related to the runtime data, so when this data has been created, changed, the name of the field, the value of the field, and also a description is if it's available. And at the bottom, you have the links section explaining the action you can do after the task operation. You can use filters, for instance, for get the tasks of a specific user. So in such a case, you specify the filter user equal and then the name of the user you want to monitor the tasks. Or you can be even more specific. You can specify, for instance, a user and specify also the identifier of the application. So for instance, I want to see how many submissions of molecular dynamics application have been performed by a specific user. So normally, if the user is not specifying a user configuration file of the front-end, of the API server front-end, together with the tasks, you can focus on a specific task. So you can get information of a specific task just providing this entry point, tasks, and then the ID number of the specific task. And you again get a JSON output containing the same information I show you before, but in this, so just one entry of this array. In order to submit a task, you still use the entry point tasks, but you have to specify as a JSON and sending as a post request the following data content. This is an example, the most simple example I can provide you. So I want to execute the application 3, and I can provide just a description of this submission. And this is enough to submit something with the REST APIs. When you submit a task, you can get two different kinds of answers. You can get a JSON containing the description of the task, and the state, and inside the status you are notified that the task has been enqueued. Or you can get again the information about the task, but the task is not really executed. And in this case, in this second case, the task is waiting for further inputs from the user. So the user has still to specify input files to finalize the task request. In such a case, you have to specify input files with other cool commands, for instance, like this. So the entry point is still tasks. You specify the task ID of your submission. And then, as post data, you can provide any input file you want with the minus F for curl, for instance, input file with the path, the full path of the file, minus F, etc., the second file name, and then input. If you don't want to, you don't have any input file, but the job is waiting for input for the user to finalize the task execution, you can send the post request without specifying any input file. So how can I get the output of the task? If you use the get method to get the list of the tasks or the detail of a specific task, inside the fields, inside the JSON, you have the field output files. In this slide, there is an example. Output files contains records like a new URL, entry point, and a name. So in order to get the output of this file, of this specific file, you have to select this URL path and place it inside the creating this new entry point for API server. So you can get the content. So you can download this file just providing this command. So just moving the information inside, containing inside the URL from version 1 till here. In order to delete a task, you can use the delete method, the rest method delete, providing the task ID of the task you want to delete. This command totally removes any reference of this task execution from database, file system, etc. So this really cleans everything. So next APIs will be related to the applications. Because before to go to the API itself, let's analyze some tables. For instance, the application parameters. Inside the application parameter table, normally we use to specify which is the executable. There is a field missing here. I'm remembering that really now. There is also a field that specifies if this application is creating a job or if this application is related to the creation of an infrastructure. This is a field that is missing here. Then I'm collecting on this table the arguments provided by to provide to the application, which are the output files, which will be the output file, so the something execute on somewhere. You have the console output of this execution, and this output is specified by this parameter. The same thing for the error file. And then another important field is the target executor. So this is specifying in the queue table which will be the executor interface in charge of consume this this application. So if I want to use the grid engine, I have to specify the word grid engine on that parameter. If I want to use Tosca, I have to use simple. I have to type simple Tosca to inside this field. I think there are examples also for this.